at what Spud wrote.
Man, I can't believe they wrote that in a yearbook.
Oh, yeah. Way to go, weed.
Are you Cokes, boys?
Thanks.
Excuse me. Oh, you boys have the yearbook out. Hey, what's this? You had Mr. Fleshner sign your yearbook?
He's an alright guy.
Yeah, but what a dorky thing to write. May all your angles be quadrangles.
Let me see this. Here's what I wrote you. Skip. Even though you're number 15 on the football team, you'll always be number one in my heart. You're steady, Ruthie.
Oh, isn't that sweet? Number one.
Our junior year, guys. What a great time.
Yeah, but next year, senior prom and graduation.
Yep.
Yeah, but football comes first. I mean, our junior year, we were one game away from state, and we're only losing one senior. I mean, you, Bush, CeCe, Newby, and me, we're all juniors. And Merrifield, Hoffman, and Hedman
were sophomores. And, you know, we didn't get a chance to play any games the following year because most of us had gone into the service and wouldn't have a chance to graduate.
So, literally 1 minute, you were just a bunch of kids out playing football and going to your prom, and then just like that, the next minute you were in the war?
Well, it sure seemed like it, because there you were in school, and the next thing you know, you're off to some camp somewhere to be trained. And,
you know, that's the hardest part for me to understand about World War II is how it changed lives, because all World War II is to me, I've read about it in a history book, and it's just names, dates, and places, but they never tell us about, you know, the average people, what they felt or thought when they went to war.
Well, they were, like you say, a bunch of average people, but there they were, put in a position they had to do a job, and guys, they must have a lot of great stories to tell.
Do you remember where you were when Pearl Harbor happened?
Yeah, I was 17. I was a senior in high school, and it just scared the hell out of me.
I was on the fantail. The band was forming. I used to like to listen to the band play. Just when they were getting ready to play the national anthem, guess what happened? We hear all these planes coming over, and now that's it. The Japs are attacking, and nobody knew what the hell was going on. Now, I just thought I was scared before that. Now I'm really scared. And when the ship gets hit, I figured it's all over. It's all over. We're all going to die.
All of a sudden, the lights came on at the theater. And it said, for everybody to go home. The Japs had bombed Pearl Harbor. So when I got home, my sister, Auntie V, Vera is her name, we all call her Auntie V, and if he was sitting in the living room with a Bible. And I got in there, and we had to get down and pray. I didn't know what I was praying about.
I played in a dance band and when I was played saxophone, clarinet. And Saturday night, we played until 1 or 2 o'clock. Or I didn't get to bed till 2 or 3 o'clock. So I slept in on Sunday morning. And about 10:30 or so, I came down the stairs. And in the fraternity house, I was a Lambda Chi Alpha fraternity, and all the fellows were lying around on the floor listening to the radio, and they said, the Japs just bombed Pearl Harbor. I said, what or where is Pearl Harbor? I didn't know where it was.
We were supposed to keep quiet and walk in a military style around a kind of square, and one of the fellows started calling to us. He says, hey, something's happened. You know, keep quiet, you're going to get us in trouble. And he said, no, this is very important, it sounds like it. And he said, shut up. And his name was Ryan. Shut up, Ryan, the officer of the day will come out here and we'll be walking tours forever. No, he said, listen, they bombed some place called Pearl Harbor. Who? The Japanese bombed some place called Pearl Harbor. Said, oh, well, that's different. So then the question became, where's Pearl Harbor? I think we had it placed all over the globe except in the right place. Nobody knew where Pearl Harbor was.
We were in a train sitting on the docks at Fort Baker. I think it's Fort Baker in San Francisco, playing poker We played all night long. And the skipper came in, a captain, a tough old bastard. Pardon me, I shouldn't say that. Anyway, he came in and he said, "Lads, we're at war." And a buddy of mine, Spats Lannan, says, "Skipper, you're drunk. Forget it." And he said, "I'm serious. We're at war."
I was out in the yard playing with the dog. I was 16 years old. And it was a nice, bright, sunny day. It wasn't any snow on the ground. It wasn't cold. And suddenly I was aware that the radio was on in the house. And I could hear it. They usually had it louder than I liked it anyway. And they kept repeating the same thing, that the Japanese had bombed Pearl Harbor, and they kept repeating it and repeating it so long I went in and said, what's this that they're talking about? They said, "Well, the Japanese bombed Pearl Harbor and there's going to be a war."
I was home on that Sunday at the place on the Sound, the home there. And I was sitting in front of the radio, and they told about Pearl Harbor. And just scared the pie out of me.
We really didn't know what had happened at Pearl Harbor, how bad it was. But when we pulled in there and you saw the smoke coming up from Pearl, unbelievable. It was just, nobody could believe that the Japanese had done this to us.
We had a teacher named Mrs. Wilder in the fifth and sixth grade. They taught combined classes. And she was a German lady, most beautiful smile. Tough teacher, but good teacher. And they broadcast President Roosevelt's speech, upstairs in the assembly room with the high school kids. But she had us tiptoe down to the foot of the stairs so we could listen to the speech. And she said, she made us promise to be very quiet. And she said, this is a day that's going to change your lives forever. This is the most important day that you will ever spend so far. You must listen.
I have the distinguished honor of presenting the President of the United States. Yesterday, December 7th, 1941, a date which will live in infamy. The United States of America was suddenly and deliberately attacked by naval and air forces of the Empire of Japan.
When Pearl Harbor happened, and how many ships they sunk, they practically ruined our whole Navy, and how this country geared up, and the women went to work in the factories, because the men all went in the service, and how we did it. It's amazing. It's an amazing story.
All of a sudden, you're a hero. Everybody's saying, "Go get them, go get them." Peculiar, but the way people changed just overnight.
And it was that quick?
Yes, absolutely that quick.
You can't imagine what the mood of the country was after Pearl Harbor. I mean, there is nothing, I don't think, in the history of this country before or since which created such a pulling together of everybody throughout society, from every aspect of our society. They just pulled together, and it, believe me, the enlistment offices were flooded with people right after Pearl Harbor.
How old were you when you went in?
18.
So you're just a kid.
Well, I couldn't wait to get in.
You want the truth?
Yeah.
I was 16.
So I lied my age and went into service at 13.
I lied about my age, which was par for the course. So I think I was 15 and a half when I went in the National Guard.
I had to have my parents' permission to go in. And I conned my dad into doing it, because everybody was patriotic in those days.
I was 24 when I was overseas.
So you were an old man?
I was an old man in the squad, yeah.
Wow.
most of them were 18, 19, yeah.
I enlisted in June 23rd, 1941, because I knew there was going to be a war on, And like all young guys, I mean, we were ready to go.
Went home and informed my mother that I had decided to enlist in the Marine Corps, and she refused. She wouldn't allow me to do it. She was determined that I would complete my university education before I was able to do anything like this. And so when I couldn't enlist in the Marine Corps, I tried to enlist in the Navy, and that didn't work. And finally, after a month of this, I wore her down and enlisted in the Army.
A lot of us, 16 years old, went to join the National Guard, and that's all we needed. We didn't need any evidence that we really were 18. All we needed to do was say we were 18, and we were in, and it was $1 a week. And in those days, $1 a week was pretty good money.
He saw my name, he stopped smiling and said, "You better go home. You know we're at war." I said, "I know we're at war. That's why I'm here." He said, "You better go home, think it's over." I said, "I come from home." He wouldn't process me, and I wouldn't go home. And I finally found a piece of paper, and I went up to the desk, and I pushed it in front of him, and I said, "Give me your name. Don't write it. Just print it, and print me the names of the rest of you fellows here in this office." And he wanted to know, what do you want our names for? I said, "Look, if they tell me on the coast that I don't qualify, then I'll come back to Spokane. But you fellows here in Spokane don't even want to send me there. Human interest story. I've got a friend working for the newspaper. Give me our names." And that's how I got processed, sent to the coast. And on 8th of January, 1942, a month and a day after Pearl Harbor, I raised my right hand to earn $21 a month, buck private, U.S. Army.
We were watching a program put on by the Navy in downtown Fifth Avenue in Seattle, and I saw all those beautiful Navy nurses. They looked so nice in their uniform and everything. So I thought, well, that might be a career, you know, to go in. So I, on May 29th, 1943, I raised my right hand, and so help me God, I was enrolled in the Army Nurse Corps.
We had to go one more physical, which at that age, you know, you sail right through, you know, because you're pretty healthy. And this one officer said, "This guy looks pretty skinny." And I'm telling you, my arms were about big around the silver dollar, because I was tall and skinny. And he said, "Take this guy in the restroom, have him do 10 pull-ups." So I went in the restroom, and we opened the door, and I got a hold of that thing and pulled, and I'll tell you, it was a strain. I got to 7, and this chief from recruiting, he says, "You got 3 more to go." So he got his hand around my waist and helped me do the other 3. See, well, he says, "You're going to be a sailor now."
They put you in a chair that has a handle on it, and the man that's testing you takes a hold of that handle, and he spins the chair. They're checking you for vertigo. And when they stop the chair, you can't help it. You dive over one side of the chair. I can't remember right or left or something like that. Well, I knew this was coming, but in the meantime, I was thinking, oh boy, you know, they're going to make me sick to my stomach, and I'm going to see the coleslaw and the spaghetti around the walls at about this height, you know, all the way around. Fortunately, I didn't do it.
They sent this memo around saying they needed volunteers up at the Olympia Armory. You know, it's still here in town. And they had people from Fort Lewis, and they were monitoring planes at night. And so a bunch of us volunteered, and we had a shift from 8 o'clock till midnight. I don't know if we went every night or whatever. And one night, the recruiting sergeant was there, and he told us about the WACS. That's how I found out about it.
There was this radio commercial that came on 3 or 4 times a day. "Negroes, you too can fly. Join the Army Air Corps and go to Tuskegee and be a pilot." And that just hung in there with me. So I did enlist, and I went to Tuskegee.
Well, it was history in the making, and I wanted to be part of it. I wasn't content to sit there at Lockheed. I could have sat there out the war like most of them did. And my mother knew I wanted to go so bad. I think she was the bravest one of us all. She knew I wanted to go, but I was part support for her, and I had a little sister that was only 11, nobody between us, she just my baby. I always called her my first baby. So she knew I wanted to go so bad. She hadn't worked in 30 years, and she went out to North American Aviation and got herself a job. And she came home. I'm going to cry. I get very emotional. And she came home and she says, "You can go and enlist now, Dorothy." She says, "I got a job." And she did that so that I could go. She just did that for me.
My twin brother had the first number that was pulled out of the fishbowl, number 158. We'll never forget it. Pulled out. You've seen pictures of the Secretary of War with a blindfold on, pulling a capsule out of the fishbowl. Well, number 158 was the first number. That meant that every draft board in the United States had a number 158, and those were the very first people called in.
My cohorts, it was a rooming house, came and jocularly told me that my number had been picked, the first one out of the hat. And I thought they were kidding, but they weren't. So I got into the Army, and it was in a small town of Tyrone, Pennsylvania. And they decided, the Elks decided, and I was a member of the Elks at the time, decided that we need a party for this man. And my friend said, "We'll get you so drunk that you'll never pass the exam." And they literally did that. So came 7 or 8 o'clock, and I went to the bus and got on it, and I was still pretty well snockered. And I went into the examining room and saw all the different doctors. They first undress you, and then they had stations, and there must have been 20 stations. Finally, I got to the last one. The guy shook my hand. I wonder what the hell he's shaking my hands for. He says, "Now you're a member of the Army."
I went down and with my draft notice in hand and said, I'm ready. So they said, "Well, you have 9 days to clear things up." And I said, "Well, I'm ready now. You know, I was only 18 years old. What did I have to clear up?" Say goodbye to my parents.
I had deferments because I was studying engineering. And I got the notice to report for induction physical or interview. And as I was getting on the bus in my hometown, the head of the draft board came and said, "Kurt, what the hell are you doing here?" Well, I said, "You didn't extend my deferment." He said, "Did you apply?" I said, "Yes." And he said, "Well, it never came before the board. Would you like to appeal?" And I said, "No, I don't think they'll take me," because I had rheumatic fever as a kid, and I had a slight heart murmur at the time. And they wouldn't take me in ROTC in college because of it, so I didn't think I'd be drafted. Well, that afternoon, I do.
My dad had informed us before we left that this is not going to be easy, and you're going to be a piece of crap when you go there. And he says, "Don't fight it. Just listen to the crap you're going to get and put up with it." And he said, you'll learn something before you get out.
We're now officially in boot camp. All the instructions, the guys with the build caps, those are the chiefs. You have to salute them. And you don't offer any suggestions. You listen to all the suggestions, and you do what you're told. And we're now your mother and your father, see? And if you're going to end up crying, we won't have room for you. You're on probation here for 30 days. And if you don't work out in that 30 days, we're going to send you back where you came from.
And boy, they laid on you. Push-ups and exercise, you know. And then before breakfast, run 5 miles before breakfast, and then come back and eat breakfast and go out and run more and then do some more exercise. And everything you had to do was on the double. If he was on a 10-minute break and a water fountain was out in the middle of the parade ground, you had a double time over there and double time back, and while you'd keep your feet moving while you was drinking the water.
He says, "Newbold," he'd do this, "I want a wet hand of sand. Take off at high port." That's how they talk. High port. So I take off at high port. Go down where the water is, grab a hand of wet sand, and run like crazy to get back to him. I hand him the sand. He goes, "Too dry. Take off at high port." Well, I got to tell you, I burned every ounce of energy I had to get there, get that wet sand, and get back up there, because I don't think I could have gone the third time without falling over. He looked at it, and he said, "Not too good, but go ahead and finish the drill."
When we got there, they said, send your clothes home. Can't wear civilian clothes anymore. And they didn't have, it was 20 below zero. And they didn't have any clothes for us, women's. They didn't have our uniforms yet. They gave us an enlisted man's coat, wool coat, came down to my ankles. Felt good.
People that were drafted, they drafted them up to 35 years old. Well, you can imagine when you were 18 years old, what a 35-year-old looked like. He looked like an old man. And I was training these old men. And one guy, it was, I could just imagine the frustration he was under. He had been a high school teacher and a football coach in California. And being a single guy, they picked him up, and I imagine Pop Derlin, as a 35, we have to call him Pop. And so Pop Derlin was drafted and sent up, and he was looking me straight in the eye, an 18-year-old kid that he'd been had on the football field kicking around, and the shoe was on the other foot. It was me giving the orders and Pop Derlin having to abide by them. And I'm sure it didn't go over too big with Pop Derlin.
This chief that was leading our outfit said, any of you guys ever owned or a rifle or a shotgun, fired a rifle and shotgun while I had done that job? So I held up my hand. Okay, and it was about, all you guys that hold your hand up there, you step out this way, and the rest of you guys are dismissed, go back to barracks, get ready for chow. You guys are familiar with weapons. And he said, well, stay here and clean these 150 rifles, whatever it was. Yeah, that was my first lesson about volunteering. But I don't think I ever volunteered after that because that was a real eye-opener.
In those days, the Army used to be run a little differently than it is today. For instance, I had a squad leader, his name was Fink. And squad leader Fink was on my ear continually until I just had a belly full of it. And I hauled off and I belted him right in the mouth. And I thought, oh boy, now I've done it, because that's a court-martial offense for assaulting a non-commissioned officer. And so I carried on and waiting for the other shoe to fall. And finally it did. They said, report to the company commander. So his name was Harrison, real nice fellow. And I went into Harrison and I said, Linden reporting as ordered, sir. And he said, I understand you don't get along with your squad leader. And I said, no, sir, I certainly don't. And he said, do you think you could run that squad better than he does? And being a cocky little kid that I was, I said, I know damn well I could run it better than he does. And he said, well, you're going to have a chance to find out. You take over the first squad. And he said, I'm taking Fink and putting him down the supply room. And which was a great surprise to me. I'd been promoted for punching my squad leader in the mouth.
We had no guns, only books, and trying to teach the kids that never shot a gun of any kind, you know. We finally got enough for the rifle range. But I whittled out a working model of the breech lock on a Browning automatic rifle, and with some rubber bands and paper clips, and showed how it'd come up and lock, you know. And the instructor used that till he got a real rifle, I guess.
And we were marching in formation somewhere, and here came a bunch of the guys in formation towards us. And when they saw us, they all started to sing, the waxen waves will win the war, parley-vous, you know, the parley-vous thing. And they went through all that, and they said, the waxen waves will win the war, so what the hell are we marching for? And we started right in as soon as they got past. Just as though we'd rehearsed it, we said, the soldiers thought they won the war, parley-vous, et cetera, et cetera. The soldiers thought they won the war, but the wax got there the day before. That sort of thing went on all the time.
Assistant instructors were armed with M80 firecrackers. Now, I don't know if you're familiar with an M80, but that's a very powerful firecracker. About powerful as a quarter pound stick of dynamite, you know. So if you fell asleep, they'd roll one of those under your chair. Well, needless to say, that was a rude awakening.
West Coast Flying Training Command in Santa Ana was in charge of the program, and they
would send observers up to some of my classes. I'd see this person there. Well, where did he come from? And they would be observing, because they just couldn't believe that a woman could possibly teach. And I was the first one that they had hired, that had been hired to do that sort of thing.
Well, there had been some stupid study earlier on which said that we didn't have what it took to be able to master the business of flying an airplane. And we had a smaller brain, naturally a lower brain capacity and what have you. And of course, they did everything possible to keep us from going in for this training, but with all the pressure building as it did, they decided finally to build this Army airfield down there in Tuskegee, Alabama, and train us there. And we went on from there. The thought at that time was that we would not succeed. We were expected to fail. And of course, we were determined that we would not fail. And consequently, we succeeded in doing what we had to do, and in a good fashion.
Advanced training plane, they called it there. They had a pilot in the front seat, and they put a gunner in the back seat with a kind of a thing here with a machine gun on it, you know, that you could move it around. I had to hang my behind out of the cockpit to be able to run this thing, you know. And they had a plane out here dragging a sleeve, and you shot at the sleeve with colored bullets. And when everything was over, they landed the plane and counted the colors in the sleeve, and you knew whether you hit it or not.
One of the incidental trainings that you get, for instance, in basic infantry training is to visually see people wounded. They had actually characters that were dressed with open wounds and whatnot. It was pretty gory.
After I left home, my mother, she rented these rooms, and more than one time the phone would ring at midnight, and my dad would run downstairs and answer the phone, and it would be some fella, and he was being shipped out right away. And so my dad would, they had a car. They weren't very well off financially. They put the girl in the car so she'd go up and see her husband and say goodbye to him for the last time.
I know my wife's in New York, and I'm in Boston, and I'm sitting here waiting for a boat to go overseas. And comes dark, at 10 o'clock, I go to the fence, climb that mother and jump over the fence and run over to the station. And I ain't got no ticket, I don't have any money. I get on, train stops, I get on. I know it's going to New York, I know the directions. I get on the train, and I figure, well, what the hell's gonna happen? So the conductor comes, tickets please. He comes to me, he says, soldier, where's your ticket? I look at him, I said, conductor, I don't have a ticket. He said, you come with me. I thought, Jesus, they're gonna throw me off the next station. So he takes me into the dining car and he sits me down. He says, sit there, soldier, until you get, where you wanna get off at? So I tell him, he says, I'll be sure to tell you where you get there. And he says, besides that, he tells the guy on the diner, he says, give this soldier a drink.
My fiance was out here in Salem. I called her and said, I've got 2 weeks leave, but I'm broke. She said, I got the money, get on the train. And she sent with the money of the telegram, the bottom line of the telegram, are we to be married? So I sent her a 50 word night letter giving her all the reasons why we should wait till I got out OCS and so on. I got to Salem, Oregon on Friday morning. We were married Sunday afternoon.
And as soon as he saw me, he brought his wings and gave them to me and pinned them on me. Oh, I thought that was rather nice. But he never told me what it really meant. It was one of his friends who said, well, you're engaged.
We had made the decision to get married, so then it became the second decision was, you know, when? Do you wait till the war is over? That's indefinite. You really don't know at that time because you're in the service for
as long as the war is on, plus 6 months. But we decided to go ahead, that thinking about the alternatives and so forth, we decided, okay, we'll get married before it goes overseas.
And we lived in a little garage, a garage that had been converted again to accommodate the military families, couples. It had a stove, a bed, and a bathroom, and a table, and that was about it. That was our honeymoon cottage. We thought it was quite wonderful. We had our own individual place. Glad to get it. And we stayed there for less than 2 months because it was on the 10th of July at Topeka, Kansas, that the bombardier's wife and I told the guys goodbye.
You come to the realization when you do that, when you leave, at least in, you know, the way, the situation in which we found ourselves, that I might not be back. It's just like so many thousands, well, hundreds of thousands of other guys did. If they didn't leave their wives, they certainly left their families, their mothers and their fathers and siblings and so forth, best friends. It's that going away, not knowing whether you're going to come back, but everybody thinks they are, obviously. And no, it's a serious time, stressful time.
What they did then, they would call you and tell you that they had a telegram that your husband, they didn't tell you that he was killed. They said that it's word about your husband. And we will bring the telegram to you. So I sat on the steps. And I just kept praying that that he'd just be injured. But it wasn't so.
At a time when you know that your husband could go overseas and something could happen, every day is precious, because you just don't know what the next day is going to bring.
Our oldest son was born in Fitzsimmons Hospital in Denver, and I left just exactly 2 weeks after he was born.
So what was that like? I mean, here's this newlywed.
Very, very traumatic. Just, you know, when you go, you don't know, am I coming back?
We lived in an apartment. We were upstairs. And when my husband said goodbye to me and kissed his baby, and he didn't go out that door. He stayed in the bottom for a while. I think, you know, maybe he was saying, maybe I'll never come back. Who knows what he was thinking. But he stayed down there before he opened the door.
Where did you get shipped to once you got in the service?
I was on a ship, and then we were on that ship for quite a while, and then next thing I knew, we were in Europe, in England. And I remember put everything on our backs and wading off the ship and going up on this beach and seeing all these dead bodies and thinking, oh my God, what am I doing here?
We put on 3 shows a day, I think, for the 10 days that we were on board the ship.
Did you take your own saxophone with
you? No, they had horns on the ship. And we had one fellow who was a master of ceremonies, and he told jokes. And we just faked the music. Somebody would dance, and so we'd fake tea for two or something like that.
Then we landed in Bombay after 32 days, and they allowed us to go up after a certain length of time up on board topside. And it was like going into another world, another culture. There were all these little men with these just little things around their waists, you know.
Well, we had the privilege of riding a ship overseas, probably the worst or second worst voyage I ever had in my life. And the latrine in that thing was up in the bow with a trough over here and a trough over here with water running through and all the slime on the floor and people trying to stand there and urinate into this damn trough, half of it going in the trough and half on the deck. It was miserable anyway, and it stunk down there. God, it did stink. No ventilation. Hope that thing's at the bottom of the ocean somewhere now.
We got off of our ship and walked across the side of a sunken ship laying there on its side right at the pier in Marseille Harbor. And then we walked 16 miles uphill We left the ship about, I'm guessing now, 2 o'clock in the afternoon, and we got to our bivouac area about 2 o'clock in the morning, raining cats and dogs, all our gear. Oh, it was horrible. That was a miserable night. We got in, they said, okay, this is your battalion bivouac area, and we turned off the road into a field that was a sea of mud, and nobody cared. We just collapsed in the mud.
After I got home, somebody said, did you have any fun during the war? I said, oh yeah, until they started shooting at me.
The first mission that I flew, going back, was over Kiel, Germany. And we came back from that mission with about 800 holes at different parts of the aircraft, and the trim tab shot out. And my immediate reaction was, I will never survive a tour. A tour is 25 missions.
I had seen planes go down and I had seen them explode, but I had not seen the fury and the explosive nature of being hit totally in almost total annihilation by fighters coming in. The noise, the smell, you can smell the gunpowder. And you can, of these planes exploding and the shells going through, you know the plane has taken it. The plane just shudders. And I think the worst thing on an attack, and these were fighter attacks, is having to sit there on that flight deck and not do anything except keep that plane going straight.
When they're dropping depth charges, you can hear the click of the charge arming itself, and then you know that shortly after that, there's going to be an explosion. It was like being an earthquake. Light bulbs break, valves spin open, and you get shook up. You get shook around.
So you can actually hear the click of the...
As long as you can hear it, you're okay. It's those that you don't hear, that you just get the big bang, that's the ones that's going to kill you.
You know how many anti-aircraft guns we had on NGO? That little 450. So you imagine we had a lot of air raids. Every day, just air raid, dive. And our planes would be up there fighting them, and then the shells dropping like hail stones, the empty shell cartridges.
I had given this Marine lieutenant enough uppers to get him going, and he ran across the field. Well, that was okay, except he gave away my position. So I took the carbine, and every time I'd see a head come up, I'd fire at the berm, and I'd fire only one round, continually thinking that I've got to conserve ammunition. And I hadn't had a scratch yet. I'm still in good shape. But one of those guys up there picked up on me, and they threw a hand grenade down, and as soon as it hit the ground, I threw my arm up like this, and I carried a .45 caliber pistol in a shoulder holster right here. And when that hand grenade went off, it went into the weapon, which protected my heart, but it took out one eye and it blew me up pretty well. I ended up getting hit with three of them. But in the meantime, before they got to me, I did a lot of damage up there.
Well, they had the new battleship, the Jean Bart, was there. And the first salvo she shot at us, the ball went through the flag and it wasn't any farther than that baby right there behind us. And they're 15.9 inches, and they weigh close to two ton, those things. And if they'd have hit our spot up there, they'd have wiped us right off. They're that big. And that's the second time I say the Lord saved me. Because we had our hatch open up here, and when that went right over the top of the hatch, it sounded like a freight train going by. And my knees just buckled. I'm standing up looking in the rangefinder, but when they buckled, I was way down. And I looked up at my main battery officer up there, and he was kind of grinning. He says, if you can hear them, they won't hurt you.
Just when we thought we were going to skim it and then hit the target, the big flames and stuff boiling flipped us up like a chip in the air, and we were upside down going over the trenches, and our engine was roaring because it had lost the bite. You know, a propeller goes through the air like a screw. I could look down, I could see those Japs in their trenches, and they were cowering, and I was cowering.
So we marched into town and pretty much spread out, but on either side of the road. And they got some fire up at the head of the column, so they stopped the column, and we all just sat down and was resting our heels. And all of a sudden, these Japanese had hidden their tanks in the buildings, and we hadn't sent out reconnaissance to the flanks to look in the buildings. And the front of the buildings came down, and here come the tank and the infantry. They caught us flat-footed. They just came in from both sides, and our guys, being seasoned troops, and that was the only thing that did it, we laid down with our bazookas and our rifles and one thing another, and we returned fire. We knocked out 13 tanks, and I don't know how many infantry we put away.
So we couldn't get back with damaged aircraft. And the Air Force called O'Hara and could they fly cover for us on this Balikpapan? Oh, yes, sir, we could fly, he said to the general, but you know, we couldn't fly back, sir. That's too far for our capacity to fly back. And we'll have to ditch. And he said, well, suppose we have some Navy submarines and other light cruisers, et cetera, out there to try to pick up all of you. Would you fly it then? He said, do you mind if I ask my men? They volunteered. Brings tears to my eyes. I'm sorry.
That's okay. No, just if you need to stop or...
They volunteered to a man. And a lot of them were lost flying back because they couldn't fly that far. They ran out of gas.
When they had a bonsai attack, we knew that we were on our way out. That's all there was to it. When you got 2,000 guys that are coming at you and they're not going to quit, and you got about 100, 150 or something like that to protect them. So they came through that night, the evening just before night, and they said, look, fellas, when you go back to your tent tonight, remember, if the Japanese attack, if there's a bonsai attack, do not back up. There's no place to go. In other words, you stay there till you die.
We drove down Jackson Street, and a white child was picking on a Japanese child, and my sister said it started already.
Some of our friends, for crying out loud, in school were Japanese. How could you be mad at that boy or girl? Some of the things that happened to those people, the concentration camps that the state of Washington put people in, and others, other states did as well, was an unbelievable thing. And yet, the powers that be, the government in general, couldn't see the forest for the trees. The only thing you can tell by looking at 10 different Japanese lined up in front of you is that they're all Japanese.
I think the first inclination we heard was somebody said, you goddamn Japs. Yeah, look what you did. And we didn't know what was happening. And of course, I'm 12 years old, I'm 13 years old, and we saw a couple guys throwing windows through, rocks through the windows of the Japanese stores.
Being 14, we knew nothing about racism or anything like that. You know, we were not involved in that. We didn't know anything about it. We're backward people, farmers, you know. So we're not aware of that until after the war broke out. Then all of a sudden, we start seeing different changes in people, in friends, and attitudes at school.
We lived about 3 miles from town, so we'd ride our bicycles to town and go see the movie, my brother and I. So we stopped and had a cherry Coke, and this white gentleman came up. And he was obviously, he's kind of drunk. I think he was drunk. And he sat down next to us, and we were sitting at the counter, and we were talking to our friends and so forth. And he said, did you ever see one of these? And he pulled out his wallet, and he showed it to me. And I said, no, I've never seen one of those. It was a Jap hunting license issued by the state of California. It was fake.
To us, that change, it was a kind of a mixed feelings. No more getting up at 5 o'clock in the morning. And we didn't have running water, hot water, or electricity. In camp, we had all that. We had a communal shower. We started making a lot of friends. You know, we never saw so many Japanese people assembled in one place. It was a kind of a novel idea for us.
And I remember we pulled up to this god-awful place in the middle of the desert out by Twin Falls, Idaho. And it was the end of the siding of the railroad stop, right in the middle of this no place, nothing, except a bunch of buses were waiting for us. And they took us off the, and my mother said, this, the Taihinatoko desna, I mean, it's a terrible place.
We were dying for a hamburger and a Coke. So we got a pass and we went to Cody. But before we went to the mess hall, the chef says, I'm gonna make you a rice ball. I said, I don't want a rice ball. I'm going to go into Cody and get a hamburger and a Coke. He said, I'm going to still make you a rice ball. I guess he knew something I didn't. Because when we got into Cody, before we played tennis, and then we went to a restaurant. And we started walking down, and there wasn't a place that didn't have no Japs served. No Japs wanted. We couldn't buy a hamburger and Coke.
For me, it wasn't too bad. You know, there was a lot of things. But don't forget, when you're about 15 years old, for about that age, you think about girls, sex, smoking, and becoming socially adjusted to the world that you live in.
I was getting angry. I didn't like the idea that we were forced into these camps, into these barracks. Communal baths, mess halls. We were told that we were being sent here to so that we were being protected by the white community. So our question at that time was, and why are the guns pointed at us?
The older people were just basically devastated. They were just devastated. You know, they didn't know where we're going to go, what's going to happen to us, da-da-da-da. Here, we gave up everything. We're sitting here in this barracks and this... And so the young people kind of kept things going. On the 4th of July, we had a community gathering in the widest part in between the barracks section, and the kids put it on like a, you know, like a pep rally and, you know, all this stuff and music. And we had our band, orchestra, they had formed their own orchestra. And they built this stage, big high stage, and they had this program, for a 4th of July program. And we closed that program with everybody singing God Bless America.
There were blue points and red points, and right now I don't remember which was which. There were little ration books about like that with little stamps you could tear off, because one time when I was at college, I had to help plan a meal, and I had to tell all the other girls who were coming to this meal to bring so many points so we could order the things we wanted. And then they had little round coins. They weren't made out of metal, but they were kind of a wood fiber stuff. And they were red and blue, too, and they were smaller than a dime.
Sugar was rationed, of course. And Mom did a lot of canning, as I said, and canning with honey. I remember there was somebody out at Forks that had fireweed honey, and it's a wonderful honey, but it's darker than some honey, and that was readily available. And Mom made she used to win prizes for her cakes at the fair, and she learned to make a honey cake, which was heavier.
All we could get was margarine, and it came in a little bag like this that you had to squeeze and get the coloring and the flavoring mixed in. And it tasted terrible. And when I went to a little store one time, I said to the man behind the counter, because it wasn't a market like you have now, I said, don't you have any butter? I'm so sick of eating this stuff. He went in the back room and he found me a quarter pound. I don't remember what I paid for it. I'm sure it was more than I should have, but it sure did taste good.
When I was pregnant, I had a real yearning for ketchup. And I wanted it so bad, so I held up my ration points for a long time and I bought it. And when I came home, the apartment I had a tile floor, and I dropped it. And I sat on the floor and cried. And there went my ketchup.
Couldn't get any nylon hosiery for work, but he sent me two pair of silk stockings from Cuba. It was either those two pair or you had to wear that makeup on your legs if you wanted to be dressed up, the women. They had different shades of that. It was messy, really, because you'd get your clothes, it would rub off on your clothes, a certain amount of it.
So you didn't make a nylon pattern? You just
oh, no.
Painted the
oh, some of them probably put a seam up the back, I suppose.
I wanted to build airplanes because my dad and my brothers and that were in the service, you know, and I just wanted to, I wanted to be in doing my part of it too. They had all these parts. Say they had a big pile of them up to the ceiling, and they had to, maybe there was two or three pieces to it, and these three pieces had to be all riveted together, you know. And so, to start out with, we had to learn to read blueprint, you know, and know where these parts went to, and all that. And then we had to know what kind of rivets to put in them. And we used machines, and there wasn't too awful much hand riveting at that time. After I sent my part that I had put together down the line, you know, the assembly line, and pretty soon it just came out to be a big wing. You could go down the line and see them, you know, when they come out to go out on the field, you know, for their last test and everything like that. Well, you could go down and look at them. You were proud of them.
Did instantly, war's over, and they said, thank you?
Yes, goodbye. We had no jobs. Marvin couldn't find a job or anything back there, and he went down and he got some unemployment. But when I went in to get unemployment, they kind of just laughed at me. They wanted asked me what I'd been doing, you know, what job I'd been doing, and I said I'd worked in aircraft. You know, and I wasn't lying to them or anything. And they just kind of pondered the situation, you know. And then the man said to me, can you make a bed? And I said, certainly I can make a bed. He says, we have a maid job for you.
There wasn't one single solitary nice thing about the Bulge. Nothing.
It got so bitterly cold in the Battle of the Bulge that he got frostbitten toes. Many men got trench foot, which was their toes would start to turn blue and then black. And then we got the order that trench foot was no longer evacuable. It meant that men that who could hardly walk still had to fight. It's almost like men walking on stumps because their feet are frozen.
You'd wake up and you have to pee on your M1 in order to get it to function again because it'd be frozen solid.
You knew you were going into a battle because they would dole out the bandoliers of ammunition. And usually you got five bandoliers of ammunition. You also had an ammunition belt across which carried your canteen, your entrenching tool, your bayonet, and the first aid pack. And most of us tried to get two because, you know, they were important.
In the books, they said when you get under mortar attack, you hit the ground. Sometimes that's a good rule. But not when you're in the woods. Because the mortars, when they hit the tree branches, they blow. And the shrapnel from the mortars goes down like that. If you're flat on the ground, you give them the maximum surface area to hit. What you do is you play like you're a Greenpeace or you hug a tree. as close to that tree as you can. You got a tin pot on your head, and with luck, any of the shrapnel will come down on the tin pot. But if not, it's got a straight line, so mostly it'll just graze you.
You've heard of Rambo. Well, he must have been the first one because he had a strap over his shoulder, and he had his machine gun like this, and he had the cartridge belt. He's got it slung over this shoulder, and he said to me, I said, who are you? He says, I'm from C Company. I said, where's your squad? He says, I don't know where the hell they are. He says, do you mind if I join you? I said, hell no, this is real good. So we went up the hill, and you couldn't imagine the accuracy of his fire. It was absolutely unbelievable. When you're fighting like that, the enemy ceases to be a personality or a person. It's the enemy. And when you draw a bead on him, you don't think this is another human being. After the first one or two, it gets easy. The first one is the hard one. That one kind of shakes you up badly, and the second one you kind of hesitate, and then from then on you realize these guys are going to do it to you if you don't do it to them.
And I find a German in his foxhole fast asleep, and I thought, oh, you bastard, I could kill you right now. And I didn't, so I took his rifle, wrapped him on the head, and said, get out, roust him. So he gets up, and of course he doesn't want to get shot. No, he's coming out and all that shit. And he says, I said, turn around. So he turns around, and the Germans only had a mess kit on their back. And a long, tapered thing was well insulated. And I was hungry in hell. So I took this from him, and he had wurst and potatoes and some, I don't know, sauerkraut or something in there. I ate the whole damn business.
We had various incidences where we would not fire on each other. For instance, at one time, we had killed a cow, or a cow had been killed out in the field, and the Germans wanted food, and we wouldn't have minded a little fresh meat either, so we just waved the flag, and both sides came out, cut what they wanted, went back, and then the shooting started again.
In a firefight, you can tell whether the bullets are coming at you or not. When they go by your face, they make a snap like that. And the louder that snap, the closer the bullet is to you. And you go by that. You make yourself as, you know, the only reason I'm here is I was faster hitting the ground than anybody I know.
We sat around, we talked about everything under the sun in my little CP group when we were in that bunker that you saw. In the Maginot Line, I had six or eight guys in there, communicators, fire control people, that type of guys, who were the more intelligent people, and we had lots of good old bull sessions. And every once in a while, we'd be sitting there bull sessioning, and the phone would ring, and there would the yell would be fire mission. And we'd immediately go into action and fire a mission. And they'd go to their particular assigned duties, and we'd fire the mission that might last 5 minutes, might last 5 hours.
I was on outpost duty in 100 yards in front of the company out in the hole. You're supposed to call in every hour, and they're supposed to call you and see whether you're still awake or not. And the phone rings, I pick up the phone, and the guy starts talking to me in German. So I answer him in German, and my company commander gets on the line, and he said, what in the hell, God damn it, what the hell's going on? I said, there's a couple Germans on the line. He says, oh, you're full of shit. I said, no, I'm not. He shut up. And the German said to me, we know exactly where you are. I said in German, that's good. I'll be waiting for you. And I never saw him that night. But I never slept a wink that night.
Quite often, you just sat there and waited to see what was happening, and you were within eyesight of the next foxhole on either side, and you'd crawl over and talk to him, crawl back and crawl over the other fellow and see what's doing.
We were cleaning the woods. We came to this about 100 yards of open country, and I said, I guess we got to cross this because there's more woods down the road. And I looked at the and I said, okay, guys, we're going to cross this. We're going to cross it as fast as we can. We get on the other side. We're going to get down in the. And we ran across that, and I looked on both sides, and every guy was, you know, nobody stopped. Nobody worried, said, maybe we oughtn't do that. They did it. And I thought, my God, these are Americans, you know, they're different.
We were short on food. I recall one time we were just about out of it, and we found a wild pig, and I was an old butcher from the Willapa, so we butchered the pig and cooked it, and everybody ate, and if you have the diarrhea, in those days we used bismuth and paregoric, And it took 2 gallons to get them back fighting again. Everybody had the diarrhea. There was quite a few questions of what happened to the 3rd platoon, but that's what happened. They ate too much pig that was not properly prepared.
We was up there in the invasion of Iwo Jima, and of course was this old destroyer didn't have very good, you know, supplies and stuff aboard. So we had to be reprovisioned every week or so by another ship. Well, we was relieved off of a picket duty one day and went over there in the anchorage looking for the ship that was supposed to pre-provision her, and she wasn't there. And nobody knew where she went. Well, come to find out, she'd been hit by a suicide plane and went back to Ulithi. But for some strange reason, communication got balled up. We ate spaghetti for 21 days. Macaroni, spaghetti. Now that, not good.
The whole weapons platoon was living in this 4-bedroom house, I think it was, pretty good size house. And it was in March before the war was over in May. And pretty cold. And this 140-pound pig ran across the backyard. One of the guys dumped it with an M1. And it took us about 3 or 4 hours to skin that thing, because we didn't have any pliers to grip the hide with, and while we were skinning, it was just fat, and we were with bayonets and jackknives. It's wonder it ever got skinned. And we knew we weren't supposed to do it, because there was an order out against it. And knock came at the front door, and it's a company commander and a major from the medics. And I thought, my God, we're really going to get it now, because they're going to find that meat. Well, they wanted to come in and inspect the billets, wanted to see how many were living in this house and what kind of conditions they were living in. They inspected all the buildings, they come down the hallway, and it was about 2 steps up into the kitchen, and they lifted up that sheet and saw all that meat and just dropped the sheet again and took the 2 steps up into the kitchen. And one of them said, boy, that sure smells good. And old Reeves said, yeah, he said, we're going to have pork shoulder roast and cherry pie for dinner. Are you staying for dinner, sir? And this major even said, boy, he said, I'd like to. He said, but I got other things to do.
Most of the time, what we'd do is take the powdered coffee, pour it down like that in our mouths, and then grab a handful of snow to get it down to get the caffeine in us. And then we'd smoke one cigarette after another. And those were the ways that we kept awake.
K-ration's a good meal. Didn't like them. You know, a little can of ham and eggs and 3 or 4 or 5 dog biscuits, a little piece of toilet paper, and 4 cigarettes.
I started out at, I think it was 10 gallons of cream of wheat like that, you know, and ended up I had about 30 gallons. The guys wanted that because it was hot and they could drink it, you know. And they'd always come and want me to make them more cereal, you know.
In Sicily, I didn't smoke, so I had half a duffel bag full of cigarettes. You know, they give you a pack a day. And I traded 14 of them there for a big turkey. And we had a Chinese cook that, you know, the guys would pick on him. And I never picked on him, you know, I felt sorry for the guy. And he treated. So he cooked there, and we invited him over to the gun. We had a very good captain, so we brought him over. He come over, and we had a nice turkey feed. Man, that was good.
We'd take a little town or something, and first thing we'd do is go through the houses and look for something to eat. And these houses always had a can of fat, okay? And then little else, you could go in the root cellar and finding Brussels sprouts and carrots and that kind of stuff, and potatoes. And I'd take this grease and put it in my mess kit, put it over my candle in my foxhole, heat it up, try to fry the potatoes, the sliced potatoes, and put the Brussels sprouts in them and eat it. Because K rations are, you know, they're supposed to be sufficient, but they're not, believe me. you never get enough to eat.
We weren't eating with our army place, because we were eating with the Pashans, you know. René Pashan and his wife. And so we pooled our 10-in-1 rations with their food. And it worked out great, because they had deficiencies and they thought those dog biscuits that we ate were very good, you know. And we thought their dark bread, which they didn't, they'd had a lot of that, and we would always take that, and they would take the so-called dog biscuits.
We would take a plate of food, and this is honest to God, we would take a plate of food, and it would be black with flies. You take a spoonful, you and you still get about a half a dozen flies. So after the third or fourth, you just went ahead and ate the flies and all.
When MacArthur come ashore, they had to kick me off the beach because I didn't have a security clearance. I had no place to go. I put on army clothes and snuck into their chow line just to eat. Or they give me a canteen cup full of whiskey. And I was 19 years old, of course, I drank it, you know.
When you went into interrogation, there was a room here with a guy sitting in there and a couple of bottles of booze. And you could check your name off a list and get a pretty good size hooker of booze, which even at a 19-year-old was good. And then there was only four guys on my crew that drank. So this guy that dispersed the booze was not adverse to having me come around and get back in the line and check somebody else's name off. Well, now you've got two belts in you, of not necessarily the best booze in the land, on a stomach that's been empty for at least 12 hours, and you've been scared to death. So, you know, the psychological business of the whole thing is. But I think that guy with the booze helped my morale a great deal.
When you're fueling up the plane, if you had a sock and a can of beer, and you just put a little bit of the 130 or 180 octane, whatever your fuel was, put that on the stack and whirl that around your head a few times, you'd be surprised how quickly that cools that beer down.
So we tie up alongside this ship one night. She came in, and we said, "Hey, can we come aboard?" And they had a green GI up there guarding his hold. And so, yeah, I guess so. So we go up the ladder, look in that hold and hold full of beer. Oh, my heavens, you know. So we said to this guy, "And I'll tell you what, you know, you should go get a cup of coffee. We'll stand guard till you get back. Just take your weapon with you and go." So this other guy and I, he goes down the hole, like we got a rope with what we call a monkey fist on it. And we wrap it around, I pull these things up, run off the side there, and the guy down below catches it. We stole 100 and some cases, and they're 4-pack at the time, 400 cases on the deck. So what do we do with this beer? We said, well, the only one place to hide it, George, and that's up in your ammo lockers up in the bow. So throw all the ammunition over the side and fill those casings full of beer. That was kind of dumb, I admit.
One time I brought about 4 or 5 bottles of alcohol from a Japanese sub-base aboard. And how I did it, we were supposed to go over and pick up souvenirs. Well, there were bags that you had the souvenirs in. I had 2 bottles, one on each leg, and 3 in the bag. And I said, why should everybody get caught? I'll just take it all aboard for it. When I got aboard, even the master-at-arms on the ship got a bottle.
I had 5 bottles of cognac anyway there, all told. So I kept 2 till the war ended, you know. And then when the war ended, we were close to Czechoslovakia there, all sitting around about 4 o'clock in the afternoon. And then we heard the rumor of surrender, and captain called up. I mean, the rumors had come down from the first sergeant. No drinking. Yay. 5 minutes later, the phone's ringing again. Drink if you got her.
We were on the train going back to camp, and it was a little, you know, we weren't very happy about it because here we knew the war was just ready to end, and I was sitting with this sailor, and every time we'd go through a town and stop, we'd ask him, well, is the war over yet? And he finally reluctantly came through and admitted that the war was over. And So I saw this sailor pawing around in his duffel bag, and he came up with one bottle of warm beer, and that's how we celebrated the end of the war.
Mail call was one of the most important things. I mean, everybody looked forward to it. The sad part about it was there were some individuals that never got a letter. And you could just read the disappointment.
You'd hear about what was going on in the home front and how everybody was, and they missed you and all that. And it was a good morale lifter. And once in a while, you get a package of Toll House cookies through or something like that. My sister was great at that. She was a little girl then when I left. She was 12. And she would make me a batch of Toll House cookies every month and send them. And the platoon would enjoy the heck out of them.
I was the censor, among other things. All mail that went out from the troops in World War II coming home had to be censored. And man, I learned an awful lot about the men in my battery reading their letters home. You know, some of them were out and out pornographic, if you will, and others were beautiful presentations of what they think about their loved ones and so on. But and some of them were damning officers at every turn. There wasn't a good officer alive, and then down at the bottom, except Lieutenant Sherman or something like that. Not that I was so good, but maybe I had them buffaloed, I don't know.
My brother was here in the States, and I wrote him a letter, and I said, it's getting near Christmas time. Would you go and buy something and give it to the folks for Christmas from me? And I got a letter back from him, and he said, well, they would appreciate it much more if you just ran down to the corner drugstore and bought a little something for them. And I wrote back and I said, the corner drugstore is 5,000 miles from here. There is nothing.
Then we had, of course, the Dear John Club.
Did you have some of those?
Oh, we had a whole bunch of those right near the end of the war. By then now, of course, you've been away quite a while. So I was president. I got mine first.
Oh, you got a Dear John?
I got a Dear John.
So were you married or a girlfriend?
No, girlfriend.
So how did...
Well, that one upset me probably more than anything else. Those Dear Johns were kind of vicious things. You know, you had your mind and all set to go back and meet the gal, and suddenly she wasn't there.
I got a Dear John from my fiance, and I can always remember the opening sentence. This hurts me more than it hurts you, you know. It took me a while to get over it.
Was she at least gentle in her Dear John letter?
I think the basic statement summed it up just right. The problem is, he's here and you aren't.
I remember that the average age of the Marine was probably 20, 19 or 20. We had been filled so full of bullshit that we were the best in the world, and I think we were, so we never worried about it. We were U.S. Marines. Nobody could touch us.
The first thing I saw to my left is a guy about going cartwheeling about, I don't know, 15 feet in the air. He had been either near miss, hit by an artillery shell or something, and he was just flying. Just as I stepped off on that, and I thought, holy crud, holy, you know, this is not a nice place, you know.
There's a hell of a lot of Jap artillery coming at us. They hadn't started mortars yet, but a lot of machine gun fire. And we're in a little tin boat. It wouldn't stop a 50 cal machine gun. Yeah. Your biggest problem is, am I going to need new underwear before I get on the beach? And there are dead Marines everywhere, floating in the water. This guy's had gone in just 10 minutes before us. They dropped the ramp on the LCVP, drops the ramp, and he's not in very far. I take the Jeep off, comes off of the ramp, and I'm coming like balls out of hell. Comes off the ramp and drops right in the water. That's as far as it went. Says, nah, if you get in a vehicle, it's going to draw fire. We bailed out and got away from the Jeep and about gone up and dug in this soft black sand. And about 5 to 10 minutes later, a mortar shell hits right in the middle of the Jeep. blows the Jeep all to hell.
The 28th turned to Sarabachi, and part of the 27th Regiment, to start with, would turn to the north so that we protect our flank then, so forth. And then we came in, and then we filled in with the 27th turning to the right. But you look back up like this, and here's this crazy mountain, you know, and they're looking down like this at you. And it's for them, for a while, it was like shooting fish in a barrel.
What do you think about? Be telling me, I was worried more about my brother than anything else. He hadn't come in yet. But because I was going in on the third wave, and he would come in the second day with regimental headquarters, I figured I'm one of the guys that's going to get tagged, not him. We had set up a system, because he also was radio. We had set up a system whereby I could call him clandestine on a dummy code and talk to him. No talk, just, are you there, are you okay? And I never did, was never able to raise him. He got hit too soon after he got on the beach. I think that at the time of that, I guess the big thing was, how do I tell mom? My baby brother, you're a month and a day younger than me, but he's also the youngest in the family. How do I tell her that I didn't take care of him? Which is bullshit. I couldn't know I could take care of him, but these things go through your head.
We lost quite a few guys overall because they'd pick up sabers and hand grenades and stuff, you know, like that. And Bluey.
Yeah.
You know, just Bluey, they'd blow them up. One time I was on a hike up Suribachi, it was first part of March, and I found a case of Japanese hand grenades, just about three quarters full. Just, great Scott, there's a whole bunch of them, you know. Oh, it was a temptation to reach over and grab a couple of those rascals and put them in my pocket. And boy, oh boy, I can just imagine that thing being booby-trapped in the whole case of them. Phooey!
Me or whoever's in the foxhole with me or alongside me doesn't keep their eyes open, we're going to be dead. So that's the point of the day, is you don't give the bastards a chance. No, you shoot first if you can.
Pretty strong motivation.
Yeah. You don't mind seeing blood, but you don't want it to be yours.
There were rumors of Jap infiltrators that night, and by that time, six weeks had elapsed, and we were kind of in foxholes up in there, and they asked for volunteers to go up and man the radar, you know, to stand guard, and so I volunteered, and that saved my life, because that night, one of these ducks, you know, they go on land and in the water. Anyway, they came up through there and they missed their turn in a road in the sand, and this one drove right over.
It's okay. It's no.
Drove right over my foxhole. And he straddled the guy, my foxhole mate, who was right beside me, and the treads went right over where I'd have been. I still dream about that.
Even fighting can be funny. There's a lot of things that seem gruesome to the average person, but for guys that are fighting, it can be absolutely hysterical. I mean, we had a guy named Baycock one time, and Baycock, I don't know, are you familiar with bazookas?
A little bit, yeah.
Okay, you load the bazooka, and this number two man loads it and wires it up and gets it ready to go, and then the gunner is ready. Now, the loader, he's standing here. Well, this tank was traveling down the road, and this bazooka man kept following the tank until pretty soon he's pointing right at the loader. The rear end is. He pulls it, blows this guy's helmet off, the back blast of it, burns all of his hair and his face and his eyebrows, and knocks him backwards. And he starts screaming, I'm hit, I'm hit, I'm hit. He thought somebody dropped a bomb in his lap. Well, something like that. Now, that was funny. it wasn't funny to him, but to everybody else to see exactly what had happened, that was a goofy thing.
And I was the after anti-aircraft guy on the back 6-inch gun, and I had a BAR. I never shot the thing. One day the executive officer came back and he said, Link, he had a little bitty short guy, but he had a voice like a foghorn. He said, Link, have you ever shot this gun? I said, no, sir. He said, well, it's time you learned how to do it. He said, give it to me. Well, he didn't know that I had it on full automatic and those things carried a 30-shot clip. He walked up to the edge of the gun tub and touched that thing off and it'll get 30 shots out just like it. He wound up on his back. And the boss's mate, we all stepped away from him. We didn't want to catch him, you know. He got up, he didn't get up. He couldn't get up. The boss's mate reached down and got the gun. He stood up. He said, Link, you better take this gun. The executive officer turned around and walked up and never said a word.
And he said, I want to buy your dinner because you saved my life, Bob. And I said, I thought about that. And I said, now I recall. I was looking over your shoulder and I saw a Marine Corsair coming in with his 6 machine guns going over the top of us, shooting at the enemy down in the valley that we were about to assault. And I noticed he let his 500-pound bomb go too early. And my little calculator in my head said, that bomb is back there and it's not gonna get up there where it's supposed to, it's gonna land here. And so I hit Curtis and over the pig pen wall we went, and I landed on top of him, and he said, I thought at that time, I wonder what I did to that SOB, and then the bomb went off. And he said, and you and I both got up and we were shaking our heads, and he said, I drove up from Texas to buy you and your wife dinner because you saved my life. And I said, Curtis, I never saved your life. I saved my life and you were in the way.
We noticed there was a bunch of Jeeps that were being made up in a convoy to go out. So Joe says, let's take one of these Jeeps and get on the end of this convoy. And then we realize, hey, we've got a hot Jeep here. Those numbers are painted on the side, so on the hood. A Jeep had been down in a ditch, down about 20 feet into a hole down there. It had been wrecked during the invasion. So we knew that Jeep, the numbers had already been wiped off. So we went down and took that hood off that Jeep down there and brought it up and put it on our Jeep and threw our hood back down. They told us that tomorrow morning we're going to go to Paris, and so to the 29th Repel Depot, whatever that is. So we drove our Jeep up there, and we got into town, got down to where the, what they call a COMZ headquarters, where General Eisenhower was and all the other officers. We came back down to get into the Jeep to go back and pick up our gear, and the sergeant came out, sergeant of the motor pool, and he says, are you the fellas that brought this Jeep in? And this one fellow, the Joe, he says, why are you asking that, Sergeant? He says, well, when we first came to Paris, he says, we were assigned 3 Jeeps in consecutive number. And he says, one of them was stolen. Like 6-7-6, 6-7-7, 6-7-8. And he says, there's 6-6, 6-7-7, or 6-7-6, there's 6-7-8. Now this is 6-7-7 right here. So we, apparently the Jeep was stolen in Paris and taken down to the coast and wrecked. And we picked up that hood and put it on our Jeep and brought it back to the same place. And that sounds like it sounds like it could never happen. But I saw those numbers.
You can't believe I had a lot of women working on that ship, Rosie the Riveters, and you can't believe. I could tell you a story that'd curl your hair. Any place there was a place to hide, there was somebody hid. I'll tell you something.
Doing a little of their own riveting there,
yeah,
were they?
We did some riveting, all right. I'll tell you something. And some guys, when we got commissioned and had to leave there, cried. It was so bad. Cried. Lost their happy homes.
Al thought he was the meanest, roughest, toughest little guy in the world. So captured a couple of Japanese one day. And he's really being nasty. He's hitting this guy and telling him, come on, move. And he'd kick him and tell him, move, move. And they started across the creek. And apparently the Japanese knew where all the stones were, and he just walking like crazy, and Al missed one, and he fell in the creek with his rifle and the whole thing, and the Jap turned around and gave him his hand and helped him back up again. Well, it took the hate right out of his mind. From then on, he stopped kicking him and stopped hitting him.
I would go to the officers' club pool and swim, and there was usually just one other fella there. Turned out it was Robert Stack of the movies. One evening, I got a phone call, and it was from a girl that I had known in Olympia. So Barbara and I went to dinner, and we got up and we were dancing. Well, Barbara, I don't know, the calories had gotten away from her, and she had gotten rather large. And we got out on the dance floor and were dancing, and I was looking over the top of her, and all of a sudden I saw Bob Stack. And he had some very attractive woman who was draped on him like ivy, clinging dearly to him, because even then he was known in the movies. Good-looking son of a gun. And in dancing on the floor, you're turning, you know, pirouetting, whatever. And came the time when he and I were facing each other over our respective partners' backs, you know. And I saw him go like this at the back of Barbara. And he looked at me and he just mouthed the words, "War is hell." And it broke me up, and there wasn't anything I could do. I was so darn embarrassed. And so Barbara, of course, wanted to know what I was laughing at. And so I had to tell her, I just thought of a very funny story I had heard or something. I got out of it some way. I don't know. That son of a gun, I could have killed him.
This one big 6x6 truck was stalled. And so this fella from our outfit, he was in some kind of a vehicle anyway. He thought that the fella that was coming that toward the other way they were going to meet, he thought he saw them say, "Come on." Well, so he just zipped by, and as he came by the stalled truck and looked over at this Jeep, he could see these stars gleaming. It was General Patton. And General Patton was highly enraged that he had to wait for this guy to go by. General Patton came stomping over there and really read the riot act to him. And the more he talked, the angrier he got. And finally, he pulled on his stripes. And he said, "Soldier, you're broke to a private." Except that Bruskavich had so thoroughly put on his stripes that the general couldn't pull him off. But he says, "No." He says, "When you get back to your company area, you tell your commanding officer you're broke to a private." And so that's exactly what happened.
When we shoot them, we just left them lay. One guy fell in a road, and the trucks had come up and down and up and down the road, and pretty soon this guy begins to look like a gingerbread man. He starts spreading out. And there was he had to be a brand new second lieutenant. He flagged a truck down, and I had a position just on the side. I could see this guy down there, and this lieutenant flags a truck down, and he said, "You guys got a pioneer kit in your truck, the shovel and pick and one thing and another?" And he said, "Yes, sir, we do." And he said, "Well, get this guy off the road and bury him." And the truck driver said, "Sir, we don't bury him, we just shoot him." And he put the truck in gear and down the road and left the lieutenant standing there with his mouth open. What happened?
I called up about, it must have been 5 o'clock, and the girl who's my wife now, she answered the phone. I said, "Hello, hello, oh, Marge, yeah, it's Marge." I said, "This is Norm." She said, "Who?" I said, "Norman." She's "Norman who?" And I said, "Norman Orford, God damn it, I'm home." And She dropped the phone, and my mother picked it up, and everybody had the phone like that.
They issued condoms to us, you know. And we wondered what the hell. They were very useful. We used them to keep our matches dry. We, you know, tie a knot in it, and it couldn't get wet. We used them to put on the end of our rifle so the snow and the ice wouldn't go in there, because that was dangerous when that happened. So, yeah, that was the good uses of the condoms. That's the only way I used one.
First inkling that I had that something must have happened was when his letter stopped coming. And on August the 10th, the pastor of our church, I'm sorry.
That's okay. There's just no hurry.
Came out and talked to my father, handed him this telegram. It was from the War Department. It said that he was missing action.
When I went into camp, my prison number is 5,155. And by the time that the camp was liberated, the next following May, we had over 10,000 prisoners.
There were teams that interrogated each of the prisoners that came to the camp. And they were interrogating you for several reasons. One of them was they wanted to find out what kind of skills and talents you may have.
There was an escape committee. And it was always it was always something that was out there in this, but they frowned on individuals doing something on their own because it might foul up a more elaborate plan that they have. And the new barracks that were built on stilts. They were about 3 feet off the ground, which meant tunneling was very, very difficult because from where you were and where the ground was, pretty hard to disguise or to do something to start digging. But, there were still attempts to escape. Some of them just went over the wire. They found a place where the guard towers, kind of a shadow, and they attempted that. Some of them went out with garbage.
One of the things they learned was that I had a certain fluency in German, and that if I worked at it and involved myself, I could probably get along with kind of conversing with the guards and the like, and that might be useful. I remember one particular instance. There was a guard that was assigned to me for a period of time. And he decided he wanted to take a shower. And when he took off his uniform, here was the holster of his pistols sitting there on his belt. Well, I slipped that revolver out of that holster, and I pitched the weapon over the fence. And when he came out of the shower, he was getting himself dressed. And when he finally got himself dressed and was getting ready to go, he was checking his uniform and realized that the weapon wasn't there. He searched around for that weapon. He was absolutely terrified, just terrified. And so I told him that I would see what I could do, and if he could avoid an inspection for 24 hours without revealing that he had lost his weapon, I might be able to help him. Well, of course, I was able to go and get the weapon back and return and restore it to him. But the weapon I restored to him was not his weapon. The weapon I gave him back was a weapon similar to his, different serial numbers, different everything else. So now he had a weapon which on casual inspection looks like he has his. If he ever had to count for it, it's gone. And he was very cooperative.
They gave us some potatoes at times and some soup. And in the morning, kind of a oatmeal barley type of soup occasionally with, liberally
laced with weevils, but at the first look, why, you kind of turn up your nose, but then you realize that, no, what the heck, this is another source of protein, so, you know, they just become part of the normal diet.
You remember probably seeing the pictures of the old slave ships coming across? Well, we were down in the same position as that, but we weren't chained, you might say. We had a spot, and that was it. And it was messy down in there because they wouldn't let you out to the deck to go to the bathroom or anything like that. They put down buckets. And of course, everybody was sick from dysentery, one thing or another, and people got crapped on every night.
So finally, they let us come up on deck, and their toilets lined the bow of the ship over the water, and we'd stand in the line. You just go to the line, then come out, then go back to the line, and come stay in, and go around back and forth. So we had a little fun. We got into the Japanese toilets, and when they would knock, we'd go wait like we were Japanese. And that made it a little better because we could stay in there longer.
I had diphtheria and yellow jaundice, dengue fever all at the same time. And I remember the doctor's name, Dr. Schultz. He says, "You're a lucky kid." And I said, "Why am I lucky?" I said, "I know what I got." Well, he said, "This is the last shot of diphtheria serum I got." And he gave it to me, and the rest of them came in that day and died.
And they tied these four men up to a lean pole, about a 6-foot pole that was leaning, and they tied their feet back to the pole and their hands behind their back to the pole, and they couldn't stand up straight. And they were there for nearly 2 days in this hot sun, and their tongues were so swelled that they could not keep it in their mouth. And after the third morning or evening, they asked to be executed, shot. So they dug 3 shallow graves and made all of us stand on each side as they shot these 3 men.
I seen him out there one day. He was, this Japanese master sergeant was having him walk, and this one little guy, he couldn't just stay in step. And this master sergeant hollered at him. Finally, the master sergeant just got mad. He went over and took his sword out and chopped his head off. The next day, they had a big funeral for him. And that's the way they treated their soldiers, you know.
In this camp, we lost men from being beaten. And you couldn't do anything about it, and you'd walk by them and you couldn't look at the men getting beaten, and because they would beat you if you'd look at them. And he was knocked down 2 flights of stairs and he was dead. And then they, excuse me for a minute.
That's okay. Do you want us to stop for a minute?
Yeah.
Okay.
What was the best part of being in the service?
I don't really know what would be the best part.
What about the worst?
I think seeing all the death, you know. There's an awful lot of death.
When you saw American bodies hanging on meat hooks, and then later on you saw German bodies on meat hooks, what can you say? War is hell.
If an enemy is going to shoot at you, you ain't got time to figure out what I should do morally. I mean, you're going to do what you were trained to do, you're gonna hopefully shoot him first.
I follow this blood trail around, and I'm looking in this direction ahead at the blood trail, and Kittle said, "Look out." And he opened up with his submachine gun off to the left. And what this Jap, with his legs, believe it or not, virtually, they were mush, complete mush. He'd put tourniquets on both legs, both of his legs, and had crawled around in a circle and was laying there waiting for somebody to come out. He knew he was dead. And when we got to him, Kittle had nailed him with a submachine gun. He just did this.
I threw a grenade over my shoulder to where this Nambu machine gun was firing. And when the grenade went off and the chattering stopped, well, I scooped up Gerlach and headed for the tank, tried to get him out of there, out of harm's way. I didn't make it. One of the shells exploded and I caught a piece of shrapnel, just about cut me in half. Took a kidney and two ribs out of my back.
So when I came to, there's a noise in my left ear, broken eardrum, and I couldn't see out of my right eye because of blood flowing into my right eye. I don't know that. So I thought, maybe I lost my left ear and maybe I lost my right eyeball. So from this position, there were about 26 of us lying on the beach when I came to, naked except for our shorts. Somebody had cut off all our uniforms and shoes, boots and everything else. So I thought, what are we doing here in the open area? We could get strafed at any moment. And I said, oh, I know, we must be waiting our turn for medical attention so that they could tell at a glance where our injuries are. That's why we're stripped naked, I thought. And then I thought, well, I can't. And then I could hear firing going on, but I couldn't hear too well. So I, from this position, I lifted my right arm to check my face. Oh, there's my left ear. And then went this way, I could feel a jagged piece of stick sticking in my face, and went this way. And then I was pleased to discover that I had my right eyeball. There's my right eyeball. And then I started to put my arm down to my side, and then I got the message from someplace, the good Lord, the angel, and said, don't put your arm down the way it was, leave it on your chest. So from this position, I left it on my chest. Out of 25, 26 naked bodies, I'm the only one with an arm on his chest. And that attracted attention. To make a long story short, that's why I never got buried.
When people begin to talk about getting hit and how their family will grieve and one thing and another, that was a bad omen. And very likely, they would get hit. One night, for instance, I was with a guy named Peru, and we were all, you know, light talk about one thing and another. And Peru started this talk about his wife would miss him, and she didn't know what his wife would do if he got killed. And he kept talking about this, and we got to looking at each other because we'd heard it before. And we broke up our little conversation and started to get dark. We got in our foxholes. We got into a firefight. Who got killed? Peru.
As we were going along in the trucks, we were all excited. We were looking around, you know, here we are in France, and we're all excited. All of a sudden, dead silence, just as though the sound had been cut off. We had all looked to the left at the same time, and over there were those rows of white crosses. The cemetery was right there, and they buried a lot of them that died on Omaha Beach. And, oh, we just sobered up right then. It was just the most awesome, heartbreaking sight.
What was the worst part of war for you?
Losing friends that were very close to you.
It feels kind of bad that sometimes you assign them to jobs where they didn't survive the war. I had one striker, which is, like you'd say, a striker is apprenticed in the Navy. He was 40 years old and had a 5-year-old boy, and he was only in the Navy about 3 months when he got killed.
Every time before combat, we gather night before. And then I can remember looking at my squad and thinking about who are the guys I might lose.
I feel even today that I'm probably living on borrowed time in respect I'm like many, many others. I asked the question of why. Why did I come home? And so many of the others didn't.
Some of the guys who went over with, I had a nodding acquaintance, but we weren't really friends. And I kept it that way because it hurts when you lose one.
These two buddies of mine waited at the tower for me to land. And then they wanted to know when I was taking my guns out of the plane and all that kind of stuff, what was it like? What was it really like? And I had to tell them what it was really like. And one day, this one kid from Georgia flew, and the Indian and myself did not fly that day. So we waited at the tower for him to get in. And when he didn't come back, he and I cried, okay? And then one day, he flew and I didn't fly. And so I waited for him at the tower, and he didn't come back. And I cried again, and then I quit crying.
The bombing truck that I had mentioned earlier that I had borrowed from the Marines and was tying down our tent, one of the bombs hit that truck and blew it up. It was a heavy truck with mechanisms on it to make it add to the weight of it. Threw it over, I'd estimate, maybe 30 feet. And landed on a foxhole where two of our combat crew guys were in and killed them both. This gave me a lot of guilt because I was the one to put that truck there. Excuse me.
That's okay. No hurry. Take your time to...
And of course, everybody was saying, oh, it wasn't your fault, stuff like that. But nevertheless, you'll keep figuring. If you hadn't put that damn truck there, it wouldn't have killed these two guys.
It's tough to me to talk about old buddies.
I have the total army, what would you call it, plans for the invasion of Japan. But they minted 700,000 Purple Hearts in preparation of the landing, because they knew it was going to be brutal.
I was over to the 509th group, and that was about noon, and I was going to see how they were getting along, and all of a sudden I see the Enola Gay come in. I didn't pay any attention to it, just another plane. And I see a lot of brass around the area. Like, no, something's happening, or something's going to happen pretty soon. I thought the invasion, you know. And then a couple of hours later, we found out that they dropped the atomic bomb in Hiroshima. And I said, let's drop 12 more. I want to go home.
And I was there in an officer's club there when they dropped the bomb on Hiroshima. And boy, there was a lot of noise in there, and some guy came in and said they'd just dropped an atomic bomb on Hiroshima and destroyed a whole city with one bomb. You could hear a pin drop, boy. Everybody, just how can one bomb destroy a whole city?
Nagasaki was worse. Of course, there's two different bombs. One was an atomic bomb, one was a hydrogen bomb. I think that bomb exploded in the air. And nothing there but big red boulders. We found out later that all the houses were built with red bricks. That's where the red boulders came from.
I don't like nuclear bombs, but I realized on the other side of the fence that thousands and thousands of lives were saved. Actually, it probably would have been a tremendous amount of loss for Japanese, even more than those two bombs. Because at that time, they were going to fight right down to the last man, woman, and child.
Today, on Okinawa, there is a wall similar to one we have in Washington for Vietnam that has 273,000 names on it. That's all the names that they had of the Japanese people that died on Okinawa. Now, these were Japanese Okinawans, they were Filipinos, they were Chinese, they were slave labor, and I've been asked time and time again about what do I think about the atomic bomb. And believe me, after being going through that out there and seeing that you kill more people on one island than both atomic bombs did, and the atomic bomb stopped the war. And had we used the same number on Okinawa and compiled that with the amount it would take to invade Japan's homeland, the death toll would have been in excess of 20 million, and we would have lost 2 million Americans.
What do you think your message would be for generations to come?
Be knowledgeable about history. The concern that I have is if they're not aware of the ultimate catastrophic message of history, they're doomed to repeat it.
God help us if they don't learn, people in general, if they don't learn that there are better ways to solve problems than to have wars.
One thing people need to do is to realize that we are all related and we all have needs, and that we need to consider each other, be considerate, not too quick to anger, but that's easy to say when you're not being hurt.
To me, war is atrocious, and I don't think that I would like to see anybody within of having to go through some of the hell that we went through. And in conjunction with that, I think Hollywood has made it, you know, romantic, and which it isn't. But I think there also reaches a point in time that somewhere along the line you're going to have to believe and stand up for the way of life that you want to achieve. And that may mean going to war. And I think we reached that point in World War II. We had both the Japanese and the German war machine that wanted to inflict upon us their way of life. And so we said, hell no.
Every generation has to make certain through sacrifices and actions to keep freedom. I mean, to make certain that freedom still lives.
We've always had wars. I'm afraid we're always going to have them. Hopefully they won't be major worldwide conflicts.
Human beings haven't learned what the horrors of war are yet. I don't know if they'll ever learn.
I hope we never have to go in again. I was sorry to see things like Korea and Vietnam and the desert warfare and like that. I wish they'd stop all of that. There's got to be a way of stopping it, but who knows all the answers? I don't. But I think that they're going to stop it sooner or later, because they're going to have to get along, or they're going to have to kill one another. And killing is not the pleasantest way to do it.
I think war is insanity. Of course, we had no choice in World War II. I don't think we had any choice in the situation, but everybody loses. You look at it, and everybody loses. Even though we say we won, look at what we lost.
I want my children to be proud of what was given them, understand the price that was paid, and there are no heroes. The only heroes of this whole thing, the only heroes, as far as I'm concerned, were buried someplace with a white cross or a Star of David or whatever their religion was. They're the heroes. I got to come home.
I went over where they had prisoner of war, where the Italians were. It was a big fenced-in area. There were guards there. But all of a sudden, I looked at all these kids,
and I thought about the high school. There's redheads, brown hair, black hair, blue eyes, black eyes, brown eyes. They were just like us, except they talked blah, 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 blah. We didn't understand. It was Italian. Who are we? The same with the Germans. They stood up when they marched the prisoners of war down to the ship. The Italians were singing the Beer Bell Polka. When they marched the Germans down, they sung like a military march. They marched down there. They were proud people. And they got to appreciate them. I wasn't mad at them. I mean, they did what they did like I was doing what I was doing. I was told by my government, you got to go over there and hit them. Because if you don't, you're going to hit different. So that's the way I looked at it. People are people over the world. They got to learn to say hello, how are you? And instead of saying, hey, you Jew or you nigger or you whopper, well, that don't count. That's terrible. I think that is terrible.